Siamo? Okay, good afternoon everyone. Thank you for joining us today and welcome to the School of Civil Happiness. My name is Paolo Santori and I'm a member of the Policies and Happiness Village. Our guest speaker today is Professor Luigino Bruni, who is joining us from Italy, and the three discussants Ilenia Tommasato, Pablo Binkel, and Ingrid Omerzo, respectively from Italy, Argentina, and Croatia. Before introducing better our guests, I'll give you three practical information. First, for the people of our village, Policies and Happiness, the circle time after this meeting, one planned between 6 and 6:30, will be held in the Zoom room where there is the translation in Portuguese. We'll provide you the link at the very end of this meeting and of this hour. Secondly, and probably most important for all the audience, you can write your question and comments on YouTube chat, because we will have a Q&A moment, in which the discussant will select some of your questions and ask them to Luigino Bruni on your behalf. And third, very simply, the structure of the meeting. After my brief, hopefully brief introduction, Professor Bruni will give his talk for roughly 25 minutes. Then we will have three questions from our discussants from the Policies and Happiness Village of the Economy Francesco. And then the Q&A moment from you, from the audience, held by our discussants. Okay, and finally, I'll tell you, the next appointment in July of the School of Civil Happiness. So enough with technical issues. Let's come to the real introduction of this meeting. Today's talk will be focused on civil economy and public happiness. Our guest, Luigino Bruni, will give us some historical and philosophical insights about the tradition of public happiness, from Greek and Roman war to Italian civic humanism of 15th century, or maybe the first half of 15th century, its relation to civil economy tradition, philosophical and economic school that flourished in Italy, especially in Naples in the 18th century. Now, to introduce Luigino Bruni, I could tell you that he's professor of political economy at Lucca University of Rome, that he's the scientific director of Economy of Francesco, that he's a leading scholar in the studies of civil economy, that he studies and comments the Bible, but also that he's my mentor, co-author, and friend. But today I would like to say some more to introduce him. When I first met Luigino Bruni, I've just joined the PhD in Sciences of Civil Economy at Lucca University after 4 years of philosophical studies. Now, you have to know that in my former faculty of philosophy, when we talk about economics, usually associated with words like inauthenticity, exploitation, unhappiness, sadness, crisis, self-interest, greedy people. Well, as a fun fact, when I attended the first class with Professor Bruni, he started like this. I clearly remember, he said, civil economy is the science of public happiness. It was like, wow, from unhappiness, inauthenticity, to public happiness. And I thought, or there are two options, or I'm crazy, or he's wrong. Now, the fact that I'm here today introducing this meeting on civil economy and public happiness reveals what was the answer, what was the right option. Jokes apart, what I really found, still find interesting about civil economy and its ground on public happiness is that it proposes another way of thinking, conceiving, and living the market sphere. One that is different, but not opposite, the classical political economy and then economics. On this, I don't want to anticipate more. Professor Bruni will tell us something about. Coming to our discussants, once more, I can tell you that Ilenia is the communication manager for a multinational company. Pablo is from the Jesuit order. He studied economics and then now he's studying theology and philosophy. Beautiful path, let's say, and that Ingrid works for the Croatian Bureau of Statistics. But these are not the most important information today. What really matters, in my view, is that we all are young participants of the Economy of Francesco. We all came from our village, Policies and Happiness. And in preparing this meeting, I really, really enjoy having the chance to meet them, to know them, to discuss about, you know, the topic of these meetings. I was thinking that we also created a WhatsApp group, you know, and probably we'll be deleted immediately after the event as all the WhatsApp groups, but it doesn't matter, you know, what's the point? Why I'm telling you this, because when we, me and the coordinators of the village, Matteo, Plinio, Loredana, and others, we first thought about a school of civil happiness. We say something like this, look, this school should be aimed at giving us a toolbox to understand important and complex issues of today. And from then, we can theorize criteria, we can imagine criteria to design our policy proposal for the meeting with the Pope in November in Assisi. But you know, then I just realized that this is just part of the aim of this school, as well as the number of people attending the meeting today, still little, very little about the success of this initiative. What is to me the real point, the real core of the School of Civic Happiness is that after the meeting with the Pope and all the meetings of this school, we will be able to organize another School of Civil Happiness, a school where Pablo, Ilenia, Ingrid are the speakers, are the keynote speakers, and Luigino Bruni, Jeffrey Sachs, Amartya Sen, Vandana Shiva, they will be the discussants, you know? And this, I believe, is the core principle that should guide us in, during these meetings. This is the core principle that rules the School of Civil Happiness. And this is in accordance to what the Pope wrote to us in its invitation, letter to Assisi. I had the chance to read the letter today and I rediscovered this beautiful expression employed by the Pope, you know, workshops, economy of Francesco as a workshop of hope, cantieri di speranza in Italiano. And the School of Civil Happiness will be our workshop of hope if we will be able to organize the second round. As I told you, with young participants of economy of Francesco as keynote speaker, and senior scholar that we thank, we are grateful to them for accompanying us in this path, as discussants. Enough. With that, I turn over to Professor Bruni, and I thank you, thanking him very much for being with us today. And so, Professor, the floor is yours, if you are there, because I know that there are some problems. Some
delays. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, thank you for the introduction. Thank you for the idea of organizing this School of Public Happiness, Civil Happiness. Actually, also Civil Happiness is also the title of a book of mine that I wrote now. Actually, it was my PhD with Robert Sagden some years ago, and that became a book in 2006, but is still part of my research activities. And okay, I will try to share if I'm allowed. I'm trying to share my screen if it's possible. I will try because I'm not very good in. In fact. Can you see?
Yes, Professor.
Yes, you can also call me Luigino. Luigino,
no, yes.
Professor. Okay. This idea, the relationship between felicitas publica and private happiness, or felicitas privata, that is was in Roman Empire or in Latin, is something that can be interesting for the economy of Francesco, because of course in an economy of Francesco, both Francesco d'Assisi and Francesco Bergoglio, surely the private dimension of happiness, that is actually what is studied today in economics, because most of the studies in economics today are studies about private happiness, individual happiness, self-reported individual happiness, as you know, as you know also because Jeffrey Sachs mentioned, also Matteo, Paolo, and all people of the village policy for happiness know very well. That is actually a matter of individual self-reported happiness. But in the Francescan tradition, in Papa Bergoglio approach, what is really important is also the common good, and then the public happiness, because the public happiness was the other name of the common good tradition. That is a very old and central tradition in Europe, in particular in the Catholic social thinking. And then public happiness is something relevant for us. Then we know also after Jeffrey Sachs that the idea of happiness has a very long history, not only in Aristotle, that is very well well known, very is much today quoted, maybe not very much read, but quoted a lot. This idea of the Greek eudaimonia. Today, people like Amartya Sen or Martin Nussbaum work on that. But there are in Greek culture, there are different ideas about eudaimonia. There was not just the Aristotelian idea of eudaimonia that is already complex in itself. But there are also the Stoic version of eudaimonia, the Socratic version of eudaimonia, even the Epicurean version of pleasure, that was happiness, was also very synonymous of pleasure. But in Aristotle, we know that eudaimonia is always desirable in itself, never for the sake of something else, is the best, noblest, and most pleasant thing in the world, is the highest of goods achievable by action, and so on. And then the idea of Aristotle is that the happiness is the price of virtue. This is a very important element in the whole classic theory of eudaimonia, that eudaimonia is a sort of byproduct. If you look directly for eudaimonia, you never reach eudaimonia. Eudaimonia comes as a collateral beauty in the famous movie, as a collateral effect. You do virtues, you practice virtues, or you follow the beauty, you follow justice, you follow the goodness. As a byproduct, you find yourself happy, but happiness is not reached if it becomes a sort of intentional direct end of our action. The definition of McIntyre is very interesting, is that living well and doing well. That is Aristotle, but McIntyre also took again. And going to this, to the modern use of happiness, was already clear to the philosopher Sigdwick in his Methods of Ethics, very influential book in the second half of the 19th century in England, when Sigdwick wrote, even the English term happiness is not free from ambiguity. It seems indeed to be commonly used in Bentham way as convertible with pleasure. This is the first ambiguity. Then also as we see very, very, very soon, the expression happiness is full of ambiguity. And then also in the footnote, Sidwick said, the fact that, after all, we have no better rendering for eudaimonia than happiness, so felicity, we see that felicity is not happiness, but we see, has caused no little misunderstanding of his Aristotle system. Okay, the idea of daimon, because there is an idea of eudaimon, good daimon, there is a theory of daimon before Socrates, that was luck, actually. Also, daimon comes from daimaide, that is to distribute, is the idea that the gods distribute the daimons. Then, if you are lucky, you get a good daimon, you are happy, eudaimon. If you are unlucky, you get a bad daimon, you are unlucky. Then, before Socrates, there was a very static idea of eudaimonia. After, hello? Can you follow me?
Yes. Could you please share again the slides?
Why? Because it doesn't work, eh?
No.
Doesn't work sharing my screen, eh?
Actually, we saw just the first slide.
Really?
Yeah.
That is very strange. Oh, because I put this... Can you see now, Daimon?
Yeah, now it was visible, but not now.
But now it's fine, Daimon. Can you follow this? No?
It's a black screen.
I don't know what's happened. In this way, without...
Yes, now yes.
In this version without presentation mode. Anyway, if it works, it's okay. Can you see Socrates, the daimon? It's fine?
Yes.
Then, as I was saying, there is the idea of daimon, eudaimon, eudaimonia, before Socrates. With Socrates, there was a revolution of the idea of daimon. As you know, actually, Socrates is the master of daimon. And there is a daimon after Socrates, that is the one of Aristotle and the other philosopher. Then when we use eudaimonia, we have to be very clear to which kind of eudaimonia we are referring to. Before Socrates, that is luck. With Socrates, that is the inner God in the individual person. Or in Aristotle, where eudaimonia is very much related to the practice of virtues. But in general, we use eudaimonia in Aristotelian meaning, but it's important to be, because there are some differences quite important. But as we know, happiness today is not a good translation of eudaimonia, because happiness comes from good luck. You know, happiness comes from to happen. And then in German, Glück means both happiness and fortune. And then if we use happiness as a translation of eudaimonia, doesn't work very well. In fact, most of the neo-Aristotelian philosophers today prefer to use the expression human flourishing, because happiness is too much related to Bentham's idea of utility, of pleasure, and not the rich idea of Greek. But in the Roman side of the story, the scenario is quite different and more interesting, according to me, because felicitas is the expression, the most common expression for happiness in Roman culture, in traditional Roman culture, and felicitas comes from, that is also the basic of felicità in Italian, felicidad in Portuguese, felicidad in Spanish, so on. Felicité is not very well, not very much used in France because of the more bonheur, but is the Latin of Neo-Latin languages. The meaning of felicitas, the etymology, the prefix fe, as you know, is the same prefix of fecundus, femina, fetus, ferax. Then he recalls the concept of fecundity, the concept of generativity, and then the cultivation of humanity. Feo in Greek means to produce. And in the Latin culture, infelix designates the sterile tree, and the felix tree was the fertile tree, like the ficus or olive tree in particular. And then the idea that happiness is very much connected to bringing fruits, to the idea of generation, generativity. And also this beautiful tradition, Francescan tradition of Ubertino da Casale, when the arbor felix, the arbor crucis, when the cross of Jesus became a flourishing tree. the idea that the most unhappy tree, the cross, became the happy tree thanks to Jesus. There is a huge painting tradition on that from Umbertino da Casale. Maybe you know for the name of Rose of Umberto Eco. And also the idea of fecundity, Campania Felix, Arabia Felix, they were Felix because of the fecundity of the land. If you go to the Roman coins that are very telling, you find in the coins where there is Felicia Tempora, Happy Times, or Felicitas Publica, you find children with agriculture tools, with grapes, with the idea that happiness is related to the capacity of creation, of life, generativity, fecundity. Then Felicia Tempora, children with grapes, also women, pregnant women, at the most I like is the child over the Leviathan. The idea of Felicitas Publica is the child that wins the monster, the Leviathan, that is the monster in the Bible. Then the idea that life is nothing to do with pleasure, nothing to do with luck, nothing to do with good fortune. What is important in the Latin Roman tradition of happiness, public felicità, happiness has to do with generativity, with children, with life, and then with virtue, the cultivation of virtue. Then there is a link between Felicitas and Eudaimonia, in particular after Socrates. Then it's not the same to use the expression, the words happiness or felicità. They are the traditions are very different, are not actually the same. Then it's not by chance that the Italian civil economy, starting from civic humanism in for 15th century in Italy, in particular in the center of Italy, Tuscany, Umbria, Emilia Romagna, so on, then the idea of a good life was very much related to happiness. Actually the same expression of felicità came again in civic humanism. I say this is the expression of Garen, that is a great historian of ideas, Eugenio Garen. But then with the Renaissance, with this new season of the expression, also with the new season of estimation of Roman culture, there was also a new season of happiness, in particular of public happiness, related to civil life, de vita civile. The idea, the happy life is the city life and not just the countryside. Why? Because in the countryside there was still the feudalism. The idea that happy life is a public happiness, but public happiness requires cities, civic. If you go to Lucca, no, this is a beautiful city of Tuscany, you find in the wall, in the door of the city, this beautiful Libertas, no, this word. But Libertas was inside, not outside. The idea that cities were the reign of Libertas, of community, of civic life, of public happiness. Then also Rousseau is an important figure. There's no time for that. In the Geneva manuscript, the idea that public happiness, felicité publique, in his expression, is not, as he said, the sum of private happiness, as in Bentham, but is something different. The idea that the public, the felicité publique, the public happiness, felicità pubblica, is not the utilitarian version of the sum of each individual. There is something important in the body itself. The happiness of the body is not just the sum of the happiness of the fingers and so on. There is the idea that the society is something that you must look. Of course, there is the risk of an approach a bit holistic. We know that. It's not easy to put together the liberté, égalité and fraternité, we know. But the idea that is not the Bentham view. In economics, actually, the mainstream became the pleasure idea of happiness, the individual idea of happiness. And today's studies of happiness as much more closer to Bentham than to Aristotle or the Roman Felicitas Publica. Not by chance, the most important paper by Kahneman in 97, the Nobel Prize, Kahneman, is called Back to Bentham. in inaugurating this season of happiness studies. Then what I would like to stress, the public happiness tradition, the Roman, the Thomas Aquinas, common good, the civic humanism, and then civil economy, as we see in a few moments, Naples and so on, are not actually the very, there is a sort of dichotomy, huge diversity between this idea of public happiness and the contemporary studies of happiness, very much based on Bentham, very much based on individual, are very interesting stuff, but I'm just trying to say that are different. And then Achille Lori, an important economist in 20th century, wrote that Paolo Santori studied a lot, wrote, all our Italian economists are dealing not so much like Adam Smith with the wealth of nations, but with the public happiness. The idea that the English, the mainstream economics studied wealth, the Italian studied public happiness. Public happiness became a sort of motto, coat of arms of the Italian economist. And then an important historian of 19th century, Giuseppe Pecchio, said, wealth is English, happy Italian. This is very important, true. The idea that the happiness, public happiness, is a way, why? Because the Italian economist was much more closer to the civic humanism and to Thomas Aquinas. That is the reason. And then to Romans. It's not by chance that la pubblica felicità, this expression was the title of Ludovico Muratori in 1749. The book was titled Della pubblica felicità. And then if you look at this book of Ludovico Muratori, you find the reference to the Roman Empire. And then also people like Pietro Verri wrote on happiness. Most of the Italian economists wrote papers on happiness. Muratori, there is a lot of references in his book to Solomon Kindos, but also to the Roman emperors like Titus or Trajanus. And then the idea that Seneca, Cicero, Livio, these kind of people are behind pubblica felicità tradition, not Bentham or Epicurus or the idea of pleasure, the idea of fecundity, generativity, public happiness, and not just individual happiness. And then what we find in the civil economy tradition. The civil economy tradition is the other side of the same coin of public happiness. You find public happiness and civil economy, two names for the same tradition, in particular in Italy, but also in Spain, in Portugal, in most of the neo-Latin Europe, the southern Europe. You find three elements in this tradition of public happiness and civil economy. A, the transformation of individual into public happiness is not easy, because public happiness is not an aggregation or just a sort of invisible end, an intentional result of private interest. The public happiness in the Smith tradition is a sort of invisible end mechanism. Individual seek private interest, and invisible end creates the public happiness that is, in his language, is the wealth of nations. In Italy, no. In the civil economy, if you want public happiness, you have to look for public happiness. It's not enough to look for individuals. There are the politicians, there are people who have to look for public happiness intentionally. In particular, with the issue of public goods, the issue of education, in particular, Genovesi was very much obsessed by the importance of school for everybody, for children, because without education, he said, there is no public happiness. Then it's not enough to look after the individual happiness for public happiness. The transformation problem from individual to public is not easy, is not immediate, is much more complex than in the wealth of nation in Adam Smith's idea of visible end. Second, public happiness is a sort of public good. And then there is a very strict connection with the natural law tradition of scholasticism and civic humanism. Then public happiness is another name of common good, not just public good, bene comune tradition. And then if you would like to understand what was going on in Naples, you have to study Thomas Aquinas, you have to study the scholasticism and so on, because my theory also with Paolo Santori is that civil economy is the last landing, is the last approdo of the common good tradition in the Middle Age. The what was called bene comune tradition of Thomas Aquinas scholasticism became in modernity civil economy in Naples and in Italy. Then the third element, there is a direct link between public happiness and civil virtues. This is a very huge issue, but there is no time because I'm about to finish because my time is over. But it's not by chance that you don't find anymore the virtue ethics tradition in northern countries after Reformation. After Martin Luther, after Calvin, was very, actually the virtue ethics that was the mainstream ethics in the Middle Age, Aristotle, even Seneca, or Stoic ethics, or Thomas Aquinas, of course, virtue ethics was the basic ethics in the Middle Age, and even in civic humanism. But in order to have a virtue ethics vision, you must have a positive anthropology. Because if you don't trust men and women, if you don't rely on human beings, if you think that human beings are so sinful that they are not able of virtues, it's impossible to imagine a virtue ethics. In fact, after Reformation, that is based on a very pessimistic idea of men, of Martin Luther, that the original sin is so important that people are not able anymore of practicing virtues, but just interest. This is an important issue, that invisible end that transforms self-interest in wealth, but because people are not intentionally able to do that. Then, some of you know, I think that behind the political economy in the modern, there is a very strong anthropological pessimism that we cannot rely on virtue, we must be content with the self-interest. But in the Catholic countries, Thomas Aquinas was still very important. And then the civil economy is still based on a virtue ethics because there is still an idea, a positive anthropology, a positive idea of man. Of course, we are wounded, but not so wounded to be unable of public virtues in public sphere, but with the mediation of institutions. Then the role of institutions as a mediator are very, very important in the Catholic country. Think about Amintore Fanfani and the mediated capitalism. You need intermediate bodies because there are sins in the people and you need mediations, but virtues are still possible. Then virtue ethics remained just in the Latin countries of Europe and not in the northern countries. Then when today Robert Sagden and I wrote Reclaiming Virtue Ethics for Economics, this paper a few years ago, what was very difficult to publish that paper in mainstream journals because virtue ethics is not anymore the language of economics, because the language of economics is individual happiness, self-interest, utility, because virtue ethics was actually eliminated by mainstream economics, but not by civil economy. Civil economy is also a theory of virtue ethics. To conclude, this in fact is not by chance that you find a lot of virtue ethics in the main economist of civil economy. Paolo Mattia Doria, the master of Genovesi, the true essence of civil life is the helpful exchanging of virtues and natural faculties which men give to one another with the ultimate end of obtaining human happiness. Isidoro Bianchi, the famous economist, famous just for me, no happiness without virtue. And Antonio Genovesi, the more you work for interest, the more you must be virtuous, unless you are a fool. Is a universal law that we cannot make ourselves happy without making others happy as well. This is also the sentence of our course of civil economy. I'm stopped now because my 30 minutes are already over, but I'm very happy to dialogue with the, you, young people, that you have prepared some ideas, some contributions, some questions. Thank you very much for your attention. Sorry for my very poor English. Sorry, stop share. Yes.
Hello, Luigino. You hear
Ciao.
Me?
Ciao. Yes.
I am Pablo from Argentina. I am a Jesuit scholar.
Congratulations. But you are all the economy of Francis and the economy of Ignatius also.
Could be, yes. Well, it's an honor for me to talk to you, to ask you a question. I was thinking about eudaimonia and civil happiness. You said it was a sort of byproduct of cultivating virtue, right? I was thinking of this person that Aristotle proposes. He, the person, a virtuous person is someone, of course, committed to common good, but somehow he knows all the time what to do, what to say. He's somehow impassive or doesn't suffer even when things go wrong. And on the other side, well, this person chooses always the middle point, the golden mean, right? On the other side, we have our event is inspired by Saint Francis' life. And I don't know to you, but to me, he doesn't speak very much about middle points. He's very extreme in his options, in his desire to become a brother to everyone and to be open to others' needs. He would embrace extreme poverty, for example. He, in his rule, he would tell his brothers, he would forbid them strictly from receiving money at all in any form. So all these extreme options, right, from Saint Francis, to be open to fraternity, to the suffering of others. How do you think that this idea of civil happiness and Saint Francis' options for fraternity, or his idea of perfect joy, can reconcile or connect? That would be my question.
Thank you very much, Pablo. But I think Francis, Saint Francis, Francesco was very... was very skeptical about happiness in traditional way. I'm also skeptical. Personally, I wrote a book that is called Happiness is Not Enough, because I, as I try to say, happiness, if happiness is a word of generativity, cultivation, if happiness is a word to say children are important, the happiness of the most important happiness is the happiness of our children, not ours. I think I'm happy with happiness, but if happiness is intended as the goal, the main goal of human be of human life, I think is a self-defeating way of looking for a good life, because a good life arrives if you look for other than happiness, according to me. But this is my personal philosophy ideas. But yes, I agree with you. Francis also has many saints, many great human beings that we esteem today, you know, like Gandhi or like Nelson Mandela or like Martin Luther King. I think when we think of them, we don't think people maximizing happiness, but we imagine people following a voice, a vocation. If you also my grandfather, no, my grandfather was a farmer with the seven daughters. I knew him very well because he died very, very late. But it was impossible, it was totally ununderstandable for him, a question like, nonno, are you happy? It's a kind of stupid question you're asking me. Mm-hmm. I have most important things to do than happiness, no? I think because for... The traditional culture was not very much interested in individual happiness, but in individual rights, in individual... When we invited Martha Nussbaum in Italy for a congress, we presented the traditional result about happiness, the paradox of happiness. And then she said that in the US, it was, according to this graph, this figure, this graph, there was a collapse of happiness about 60s and 70s. And she said it's normal because in that moment, people in US was fighting for rights. It was the feminist movement. It was the black movement. So when you fight for rights, you are not happy. But you are doing beautiful things even though you are not happy. No? Then happiness is not enough. Saint Francis, I think, but at the same time, the Franciscan movement did a lot for improving the happiness of the poor people. Because this is another story. Then maybe for me, I know for my vocation that happiness is not important, but I know that for poor people, to work, to have some income is important for their happiness. Then I can choose to spend my life for increasing the well-being of the poorest. That is important. Because probably, as we know today, money, wealth is not very important when you are already wealthy, but wealth and income and salary are very much important if you are poor. And then the Francescan become the inventors of the first popular banks, Monte di Pietà, as a way of increasing the well-being of the poorest in the city. No? Then you can say happiness is not enough, but in saying that, you can spend your life in increasing the happiness of the poor people in society.
Thank you, Pablo.
Dear Professor Bruni, may you hear me?
Yes.
So thanks a lot for your interesting insights. And also thanks to Paolo that led us through them along these weeks. I'm Ilenia, and I'm in charge of promoting sustainability within the company I work for, and try to embed it at the heart of our brands. Reading your articles in the last weeks and listening to your words now, I'm thrilled to understand how business entities and corporations can support this shift from a traditional capitalistic economy to an economy where social values and happiness are more at the center of the decisions business can do. I have in mind, for example, some models that maybe can inspire young people in developing better business choices. For example, Brunello Cucinelli, the famous Italian entrepreneur of luxury clothes, that has started a relevant analysis of what's called humanistic capitalism. And he tried to put it in place in his own business, promoting a better development of the small village of Solomeo and the people that work for him and for his dream. But I have in mind also international business model like the one promoted by the B Corp movement that wants to put the benefits for people and planet at the heart of the business of big corporation. So now my question for you is, which are the values that can allow a company to be really at the forefront in the virtuous economy you hope for the better development of humanity? And if you can, providing us also some names of specific business leaders that in a way can inspire us as young people for better business. Thank you.
Thank you, Ilenia. Where are you based? Where are you living?
Well, I live in the north part of Italy.
Ah, yeah, but with this name, you look like Russian. Or...
No, I'm Italian.
No, thank you. Just two words. First, I know personally Brunello Cucinelli because he's working with us for the Economy of Francesco. I went in his private house in Tolomeo with 50... tondo oro of the 300-400 of Italian Chinese school, I don't know, with the billions of it has a beautiful house with a lot of art and so on. And we talk a lot. Then he said one thing that you think is interesting. He said that I don't believe very much in what you, Zamagni, the other economists are saying about ethics in economics, because you, professor, we are not Italian. Voi non dovete fare le paghe. You are not pay salary every month. I more reliable, more accountable, because I speak about ethics, but I have to make the pay, the salary of each month for 1,000. That was interesting in the beginning of our friendship. But no, I think that is there are important, interesting experiments all over the world, including Italy, because Italy and Europe has a much longer history of capitalism and company than the US. Because we invented companies in probably in, the first company. You know which were the first companies in Italy were the monasteries. It was a really huge companies from the economic point of view, with hundreds of people working together, or et labora, producing a lot of innovations. Most of the inventions we have, from the Parmesan to the Champagne, came from that. But also Arsenale di Venezia, the artistic botteghe. Then we invented companies, corporation much before US. Then the biodiversity is greater in Italy, because the biodiversity depends on the length of history. But I just have two suggestions for you as young people. First, business is important to transform your everyday work in something more humane and more ethic is very important. But you must remember to your boss, to your entrepreneurs, to your manager, that company is not God. Because today the great risk I see in the huge multinational company, in the beautiful companies, very much organized, is that they tend to become everything for the employees. They organize holidays, organize even spiritual retreat with the priest, with the monks, organize, of course, welfare aziendale. They organize everything. And then the idea that company becomes everything. And when companies becomes everything, economy becomes a religion. And that is not good. Then first is, okay, business is important, but it's not the most important. It's one of the important elements in life. It's not the only one. Because the risk that in a world very poor in other domains, the economic one becomes the most important. I think maybe the unique one. Second, I think young people today, in order to increase well-being, to increase welfare in the company, must ask the possibility to is of course linked to the first the possibility you have to ask the possibility the chance to your boss to cultivate your interiority, your life outside the company and not just inside, because if you cultivate your humanity inside business, your cultivation will be not enough because what we know today, business requires companies, corporations, firms require virtues that are not economic. Company, corporations live because they use non-economic virtues of the employees, that is humility, mercy, meekness, that are not economic, they are not produced by company. Then if people stop to cultivate extra economic virtues, they become very poor workers in the long run. And then ask people to cultivate your life outside the company, to cultivate non-economic virtues that are very important for economic results. This is sort of paradox of capitalism, that capitalism needs non-economic virtues, but they are destroying non-economic virtue because they try to produce internally their virtue, but the internal virtue of company cannot be enough for the company. This is a very, very interesting paradox. Good luck, good happiness.
Thanks a lot.
Is another question, Paolo?
Yes. Can you hear me, Professor Bruni?
Yes, now yes.
Okay. First of all, I'm very pleased to be here. I really appreciate and admire your work. So my name is Ingrid. I'm from Zagreb, Croatia. And I'm very glad that you already mentioned some of the things that are related to my question. I'm very interested in mutual and cooperative financial institutions and cooperatives in general, which are social, often non-for-profit, democratically controlled, members-owned institutions. And they are already part of civil society and they serve the common good. So in this regard, my question is, I would really like to hear your thoughts on their role in building of
the role of non-profit economy. Organizations.
Yes, and cooperatives. Yes. Okay.
Yes. Thank you, Ingrid. Greetings to Zagabra. I went many times there because I still have some friends living across in Krizevci.
Yes, I know them. I know them.
Then also Zagreb. Thank you for your question. Of course, non-profit organization, what we call VBO, value-based organization, cooperatives, civil society organizations, are an integral part of civil economy. We think that the economy cannot be civil without non-capitalistic organization, because as in politics, democracy is guaranteed by the plurality, the biodiversity of political parties. Only one party is not democratic. You need for democracy many parties, many. Even the democracy in the market is guaranteed by the plurality of forms of companies, forms of enterprises, not just capitalistic ones. This is one problem today, because there is a tendency towards the isomorphism of companies, just one way of understanding capitalism, and one way of understanding corporations, that is the dominant in the US, and so on. Then they are very important. They increase the degree of gratuitousness in market, the degree of values, the degree of non-predatory attitudes, not instrumental rationality, so and so. But the civil economy challenge is to involve, is to talk even to standard that I wouldn't call for-profit organization, because I don't like the distinction between for-profit and non-profit, because I think it's a wrong way of dividing the economy, because doesn't work, because to divide the world in non-profit and for-profit, don't understand cooperatives, for instance. The cooperatives, formally, they are for-profit, because they are not non-profit, at least in Italy. In many countries, cooperatives are not considered to be non-profit organization, but they are not even for-profit, because the aim, the purpose is not profit maximization. But anyway, the challenge, the big scientific, cultural, spiritual challenge of civil economy is to involve, is to talk to any kind of organization, not just to the 2 or 3% of non-profit or civil, because Cuccinelli, just mentioned, is a really for-profit institution, but I think he likes to be part of civil economy, because civil economy is a way of living the economy. It's not just a juridical form of the company, like non-profit, for-profit, because you can be a non-profit organization without any degree of civil economy inside, because there is no respect for the environment, no respect for the employees, there is not shared value, and so on. Maybe even though you don't distribute profit, you can be a small or middle company creating like the economy of communion company. They actually are for profit juridically, but they share their profits with the poor. Then civil economy is a perspective on the whole economy and not just on non-profit. For that reason, we say civil economy is not a new name of non-profit, of social economy, is another perspective towards the whole economic life, as we say, because the economy, if it is not civil, is uncivil. There is nothing between. And then our is a sort of way of addressing any kind of company and economic activity. Thank you, Ingrid.
Thank you very much.
Okay, I think we are almost done. I mean, there are two questions from the chat that I can see, but there is also Maria Jose Flores here live stream. So if she wants to put the question in 1 minute, the new professor can answer in another minute.
I can answer everything.
Okay, 30 seconds.
Maria? Can you read it? Maria, sorry, Zia, I thought it was just in the web. Thank you, Maria.
No, thank you. I wanted to ask you if it isn't a kind of pessimist view to try to like define virtual public happiness without an individual or singular base. I mean, I understand that Aristotle and Bentham have two different perspectives of happiness, but isn't the case that both left out or do not have a way to conciliate into their unitary conceptions the magnificent diversity of human beings?
Sorry, I have some problems in understanding your voice because it's a bit disturbed. I don't know if Paolo, if you got the
not clearly actually. So maybe,
yeah. Can you, Maria, can you try to repeat, if you don't mind?
Yes, I don't mind. Can you hear me like a little bit better now?
Maybe a little bit. Yes.
So the question isn't like a pessimist view to try to have an unitary definition of virtue when human beings are magnificently diverse? And I know that Bentham and Aristotle have two very different conceptions of happiness, but neither of them take into account that diversity. And if one believes that promoting that diversity is promoting well-being of human beings.
Yes, you mean diversity in general terms, not particularly related to gender or not.
Yes, to protect like all aspects of diversity. Because these
yes,
are
yes. That is one reason why Martha Nussbaum, she told me, I abandoned Aristotle because Aristotle doesn't take into consideration diversity, because for him just men, free adult are considered to be interesting for happiness. No women, no children, not slaves, and so on. And then she passed to the Stoic approach that is more open to diversity, and also Saint Augustine, according to her. Then I think diversity is very important, because as Stefano Zamagni said, equality, solidarity makes the different equal. Fraternity makes the equal different. Allow the already equal people to be also different from one another. And then being fraternity, one of the words of civil economy, as in the French Revolution, liberté, la fraternité, I think if you take seriously fraternity, you must take very seriously the diversity, because in as John Rawls, the master of Paolo Santori, wrote, fraternity is a relationship as if were brothers and sisters, as if. That means in the family, fraternity is the principle of diversity, because you don't choose your brothers and sisters. It's not elective as a friendship. Because the friendship, you choose your friends, you choose your wife, you don't choose your brother. And then you must deal with diversity, because the family is the gym, is the exercise of fraternity, because you learn how to deal with unchosen citizens, unchosen partners, unchosen friends, and so on. Then I totally agree with you. Diversity, but as I wrote in a book called The Wounded Blessing a few years ago, diversity is at the same time an increase of happiness, but also an increase of wound, of suffering, because diversity increases also conflict in society. But there is a good, but without diversity, there is no conflict, of course, but there is also no happiness. This is one of the paradox of life in common, that suffering and happiness often are linked to one another very, very, very deeply. Thank you, Maria José.
Okay, I think we are done. And so thank you, Professor Bruni.
Thanks to you. Thanks also to Matteo Rizzoli and all the team of
Loredana,
this beautiful team of our Economy of Francesco. I'm very honored to be the first to open this course of civil economy, civil happiness, sorry. Because Loredana, grazie, thank you also to you. Sorry for my English, because you are a master. Yes, Loredana also corrects my papers. No, it's true.
I don't need to correct them. It's a real honor to have you with us.
As you know. Thank you very much to Matteo, to everybody, also to people who I hope to be useful a bit for starting a reflection of the different ideas of happiness, the peculiarities of the civil economy tradition in relationship to happiness. Of course, it's a starting point, but maybe you can go deeper, you can continue in the next lessons.
Okay.
Grazie. Yeah. Thank you very much. Grazie, Matteo.
Okay. So for people, we are continuing our discussion. So we will go in another Zoom link that is provided, you know, here in the Zoom chat. And for the attendee on YouTube, let me say the next appointment of School of Civil Happiness. It will have in July the School of Civil Happiness week, which is from 10th of July to 17th. And we will have three appointments. At the 10th of July, we will have Elena Marujo from the University of Lisbon. And then we will have the 13th of July, we will have Vandana Shiva. She will be with us talking about environment and happiness, whereas Elena will focus more on education, relational goods. And I say hello to Elena, that I know that she's following on YouTube. And then the 17th, the last appointment, we will have Bishop Domenico Sorrentino, the Bishop of Assisi, in dialogue with Dalila De Rosa, she's a postdoc from the University of Turin, and they will talk more about family and economics and whatever. So thank you very much for having been with us, and see you at the next appointment. Bye-bye.